Welcome to the Mean Lady Talking Podcast, the tough-talking, advice-giving, butt-kicking show for the 2020s by the not really mean, mean lady, Susan J. Elliott.
Good day, everybody. This is Susan Elliott, host of the Mean Lady Talking Podcast, and welcome to episode 103, our special holiday podcast. Now, I was going to wait until I finished editing 102 on covert narcissism, but I'm still editing that, and I'd like to get this out between Christmas and New Year's and not have it not go out. So I've decided to push it ahead in the schedule, which is something I don't normally do. But I know that a lot of people are having a hard time this year. It's not only post-breakup holidays that are tough, but the pandemic makes it especially tough. And therefore, I wanted to make absolutely sure that I got this particular podcast out. And if it has to go out of order, it has to go out of order. I'm not going to do announcements or anything like that. I'm just going to go right into the podcast. Carl Jung said famously, "There are many days as nice, and one is just as long as the other in the year's course. Even a happy life cannot be without a measure of darkness, because the word happy would then lose all of its meaning if it were not balanced by sadness." And that's true. We wouldn't know what happiness is if we never knew what sadness is. Getting past your breakup, which was originally Getting Past Your Past, was the blog's original name. Its popularity took off when somebody asked me how to get through a post-breakup holiday. And it seemed as though the question triggered a lot of people. And many people from all over the place came asking the same question and asking other questions about breakups, and Getting Past Your Breakup was essentially born. Because people came here for support and caring, and when I do the attachment work with my boot campers and with my clients, the support and the sharing is what's so important in order to build a secure base. And a secure base is the most important thing that you need for a healthy relationship going forward. And holidays after a loss are especially tough. And in the year of a pandemic, they're tough and weird. The winter holiday season now seems to start sometime in August. It just seems to be getting earlier and earlier every single year. But that's because they're now designed for profit and manufactured happiness. And there's people who love the holidays, and they seem to not understand the pressure that having the holidays extended further and further out each year. They don't understand the pressure that that puts on the people who have a hard time with holidays. Like, they just don't get it. My stepdaughter will post how many days till Christmas all year long, and it makes me crazy. And I love her dearly, but it makes me crazy. People who love the holidays just don't get the pressure that it puts on people who've had a loss and who are going to have a difficult holiday experience. And they're going to struggle with loss and grief. And every time they're reminded of the holidays, it's going to make it worse. Well, if you have a choice of putting up with that for 4 weeks as opposed to 12 weeks, you would want to put up with it for the 4 weeks, not 12 weeks. People who love the holidays shouldn't be oblivious to the suffering of those who aren't just tingling with joy and comfort, because they're really just trying to get through the damn thing. Part of being in the holiday spirit is supposed to be about generosity and goodwill, but that doesn't get extended to people who are feeling less than happy about the stupid holidays. You know, why doesn't the holiday spirit include empathy toward those who might struggle with the holidays? Not a course of, here, let me dictate what you're supposed to be feeling. You're supposed to be in the spirit. You're supposed to be having a good time. You're supposed to be topping the tree and drinking the eggnog and God knows what else. All kinds of crap you don't want to be doing. And holiday movies and specials are non-reflective of our own experiences. And when we watch them, we think something is wrong with me, not something is wrong with the way holidays are portrayed in movies, or something is wrong with the way holidays are presented by retailers, marketeers, filmmakers, our neighbors who are putting Rudolph up September 15th. No one should be taking Christmas movies or presentations seriously, and nobody should be allowing Hollywood or corporate America to dictate how we should be feeling. And maybe some of us aren't doing that at all. Maybe some of us are being dictated to from our own memories, from times that we could pull back and feel good about a holiday. Maybe it's our own memories that we're falling back on. Maybe there are a few magical moments in our lives that did live up to the fairy tale expectation, and we want to have that or some of that back this year when we're hurting. Or maybe we think that we should have some of that every year. Maybe we think back on some really good times during the holidays and wonder why this year is as lacking. Why is this year so lacking? Maybe it's us. Are we the problem? Maybe we do have a few childhood memories, or even memories as adults. We had really special Christmases where Christmas really was magical. We can remember a time being as a small child, being fascinated by a neighbor's ornament, or hearing carols, or ice skating with the family. We remember some random year when we were small and how incredible everything seemed to us. Or the first year we had a boyfriend or girlfriend and received a gift. Or the first year we were married, or the first year we had a baby. Each of us has some joyful memory that we can look back on in Christmases of years past, and we hold out hope that one of those memories will reenact itself this year. There's some holiday spirit that we knew once upon a time, and many times we fervently wish that we could have it back. Being able to connect to those memories can make everything work. We know intuitively and objectively, based on our good memories, that holiday magic, holiday comfort and joy can absolutely exist. It can absolutely come true. But when it's not here now, we wonder why we have failed. What has gone wrong? And when we feel lonely and empty and tired instead of magical and wonderful, it feels so much worse than the run-of-the-mill loneliness or tiredness. I remember when I was about 5 years old, my older brother, he was 13 years older than me, so he was 18. He was taking me to midnight mass, and he was dating the woman's granddaughter across the street. So we were going to go over there and pick her up. And I was dressed in this little red velvet dress with white stockings and black patent Mary Janes. And I had a little black coat, and I had a Santa cap over my chapel veil because we were going to midnight mass. And my mother always insisted that we cover our heads. Even when the church said we didn't have to anymore, my mother insisted that we did. So I had my chapel veil on, and we go across. And the woman across the way was from Germany, and her tree had these magical bubble ornaments that had bubbles on them. And I was just always fascinated with them. And all I could think of was, I'm going to get to see the bubble ornaments. We go over there. So I went over there, and my brother posted me in the living room next to the tree, and he went to find his girlfriend. And the grandmother came in, and she saw me sitting there, and she just clutched her chest. And she was like this Aunt Bee looking character. You know, she had on the apron over the very starched dress, the black polka dot dress with a hair up in a bun. She was just the caricature of what a kindly grandmother on Christmas Eve would look like. And when she saw me, she clutched her chest and she said, "Oh, my dear, you look so pretty." And she said, "Would you like some gingerbread cookies?" And I said, "Yes, please." And she went out to the kitchen, and I sat on the chair and I stared at those bubble ornaments. And all the lights were out after the tree, but it was just gorgeous. And it was just magical. And many times when I think about Christmas magic, I think about that 10 minutes I sat there before she came back with the gingerbread man. And I've remembered that Christmas snapshot many, many, many times over the years. I mean, just many times. I don't remember going to Midnight Mass that year. I don't remember coming home from Midnight Mass that year. The only thing I remember from that year is that little snapshot in her front living room. And it was magical to me. I will never forget those bubble ornaments. And I felt like it was the very best Christmas memory. But in those years, I did have some other good memories. I remember my mother put Christmas lights on every window in the house. And in my bedroom, there were Christmas lights around the window. And my mother always bought blankets with these satin trim on them. And I remember rubbing the satin trim and staring at the lights on Christmas Eve and falling asleep. And that seemed magical to me. And when I was a teenager, I was in the Glee Club. And we were a fantastic Glee Club. We were one of the best in the city. And we got to sing at Grand Central. And we went up into the balcony and we sang. And I remember singing Carol of the Bells. And you could hear Carol of the Bells in four-part harmony ringing throughout the terminal. And people were just stopping and staring. And there were no smartphones. So people weren't taking our pictures or anything, which was nice, actually. The people were just stopping and listening. It wasn't like a million phones in our face. And they were listening and they were clapping. You know, we did about five or six songs, and because there were other Glee clubs that were coming in and doing songs. And the songs just echoed throughout Grand Central, and people just seemed so happy when they heard the music. And to me, that seemed magical. And then later that same week, we went to Midnight Mass. Everybody that was in the Glee Club together, even though we all belonged to different churches, because we went to Catholic high school together, so we all belonged to different parishes where we lived, and we went to Midnight Mass together, and I remember coming home from Midnight Mass, we were screaming. Instead of singing, we were screaming the words of Carol of the Bells, Hark, Carol of the Bells, Sweet Silver Bells, and we were like shouting them, Hark out the bells. And like we were just acting like goofballs. And we had so much fun. Like we were just crying. We had been practicing those songs since September. And, it was all over. And we were just letting off steam. And it was great. It was a great deal of fun. And to me, that was magical. When I was in my 30s, we went to the Somerville Theater to see This Wonderful Life. And Somerville Theater was an old, old theater. And they were restoring it, or they were supposed to be restoring it. I don't know if they ever did, because I saw a bunch of revivals there. It was great. And we went to see It's a Wonderful Life. And it was just like being in the movies in the 1940s, because it was an old theater. It's a Wonderful Life was up on the screen. And afterwards, we went to get hot cocoa. We wanted to, like, do it up completely. And it was very Christmassy. And when I came out of the theater that night, I mean, I love old movie theaters. And there's so few of them around now. But I remember coming out of the theater that night and just feeling like this is how Christmas is supposed to feel. But trying to recreate any of those moments every year is impossible. And it's impossible because a lot of years, it's not like that at all. We try to forget the years that it was less than perfect. Those really wonderful memories and shining moments are so few and far between. And they happen when you're not preparing for them and you're not hoping for them, or you're not wondering if they'll ever come. They just happen to happen. Because when I was a kid, as magical as I could think about those bubble ornaments or the years that I laid in bed on Christmas Eve, looking at the lights in the windows, rubbing the satin on my blanket, there were so many years that Dysfunction Junction was full of gigantic horror, usually because of my father's drinking. My parents would get into a huge argument because my father said he got mugged and my mother thought that he got into a bar fight, and then they got into a fight and My father said they took his Christmas bonus, which I believe because my father turned every cent he had over to my mother. And my mother was screaming at him that he lost the Christmas bonus. And I honestly, to this day, believe that he was mugged and they did take his Christmas bonus. But it was absolutely ridiculous so many times getting toward Christmas Eve when I would be worrying what fight was going to happen with my parents, how my father was going to come home on Christmas Eve. It was one of the few nights that he was home. We were all still awake. Usually got home like 1-2 o'clock in the morning. And Christmas Eve could be an incredible blowout. My mother and my sister May always made such a big deal about Christmas shopping. We always decorated our house to be seen from another galaxy. We all worked very, very hard on decorating the house, but sometimes Christmas Eve or Christmas morning would just wreck the entire thing. So if you're human and you've had different experiences in life, you probably have a mix of memories. And if you're not into it this year, enduring it from the long stretch from like before Halloween to sometime on President's Day, you're going to have to listen to Christmas songs and have ridiculous references to the holidays jammed in your face. And they don't care if you don't even celebrate Christmas for religious or any other reason. There could have been a death in your family you don't celebrate. And I know that after my mother died, we didn't celebrate it. And after Michael died, we didn't celebrate it. But retailers, people who love the holidays, people like that, they don't care or the reasons why. And it's not just retailers. It could be your friends and your family on Facebook. And I tell people all the time about Facebook Lives, and I'm going to talk about it again in the next, the Definitive Chris Watts episode is going to be on Shanann and some of the manufactured Facebook Live stuff. And she did some of that stuff around Christmas, that some of it was not a good look, not a good look for her. And a lot of people are posting a lot of shit on Facebook, and it's just bullshit. You know, it's as much bullshit as my family was when my mother always had stuff out for Christmas. My last Christmas with my first husband, it was a total sham. And we were living in a neighborhood in the city. We were very close to most of our neighbors. People went caroling. People went in and out of each other's houses. It reminds me a lot of the Christmases I had growing up in the Bronx when people were in and out of each other's houses all the time. But I was miserable. I was absolutely miserable that Christmas. I had wanted to leave in September, and he talked me into staying for the holiday. We always bought our Christmas tree early, and we collected ornaments all year long. And we were very particular about their placement on the tree. I mean, it took us hours to decorate the tree. And our stockings were always hung by the chimney with care. And our house shouted, Merry Christmas. And we had so many lights and decorations. My married house, I insisted, like, if my childhood house could be seen from another galaxy, I want my married house to be seen from another galaxy, too. And the kids were gleeful, and even the dog got into it. He drank some spiked eggnog, and he was feeling no pain. It was nothing like a drunk Doberman at Christmas time. And he actually let the kids put the antlers on him, and he didn't try to shake them off. That's how drunk he was. And the kids were just like roaring with laughter. They all loved it. And neighbors went in and out, and everybody was having a good time. And it was just like in the movies, just so magical. Only I was miserable. Miserable. I suspected that my husband was cheating on me. He was. And I held it all together for our very young children. But I was dying inside. And this show must go on. And it did. And then I lost my job in mid-January, and my life became a horror show. And we separated in mid-February, and I've written about my first post-separation holiday on here, on the blog, so I won't go through it, but it's there if you want to read it. And even after I survived that first post-separation Christmas was not always easy for me. Some nights, some years, I'd be so exhausted. I would cry myself to sleep on Christmas night just because I was exhausted, because I did all the shopping, all the wrapping, all the cooking, all the cleaning, everything by myself. And I was just exhausted. I want to give the kids a nice Christmas, but I was exhausted. And it was just some times where I didn't even want to get to the question, why am I doing this? Why am I doing this? I just wanted to give my kids a nice Christmas because that we only had each other. We didn't have a big family. And in 1995, I had gone through a breakup that year and I was working three jobs and I barely had enough money to buy the kids some gifts and a holiday meal. In fact, we were too poor to get a Christmas tree. And I kept trying to find one that wasn't horrible that we could afford. And we would stop every few places. And it was so horrible to me that I would have to tell the kids, no, we can't get that one. We can't afford that one. And then the ones that we could afford were just so scraggly, just so Charlie Brown. And I just didn't want to go home with them. And we just kept coming home empty with no tree, which was so different than every other year. I mean, every other year we had a tree. And it was bizarre to walk in the house without a tree after going tree shopping. And I didn't know what to do. And then on Christmas Eve, the very last tree stand had closed. And they went there and they took one of the remaining unsold Christmas trees. And it was a nice little tree, but it was one that no one wanted. So they brought it home. And to this day, they refer to it as the year we stole our Christmas tree. But we felt like we took in another refugee. But when we got it home, like we couldn't get it to stand up in the stand. And it was horrible. It just kept falling over. And after a few hours, my youngest son and I, we just leaned it against the wall because that's all we could do. I mean, we had put so many holes in the base and it just wasn't standing up straight. So we just leaned against the wall. It looked very sad. And the next day we opened our little group of presents and we had our Christmas meal. It was okay. I mean, it wasn't fabulous, but it was better than nothing. And we had a bit of a tree. Right before summer came, I met Michael that year. And the next Christmas, there were no economic woes, none. We had a new house, a big tree, plenty of gifts, lots of loot, as Calvin would say. We were a big, happy group, and the difference from one year to the other was amazing, just amazing. It was big and happy and boisterous, just like in the movies. Magical, just like in the movie. The year after that, we took the kids to California for Christmas, and we had a blast. And every year, we were adding girlfriends and wives and babies and this and that, and the family was getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And I remember I was living in Manhattan, and I remember going to see the tree in Rockefeller Center, and then we came home and we had Chinese food, you know, which was a Christmas Eve tradition in Manhattan, and we had such a good time. It was just such a good time. And it felt that year like the good times would never end, like it would always be okay. And then in 2008, Michael got sick in September. And this was one of the years when Christmas starting in October really felt like punishment. The last thing I wanted was to be reminded of the fact that he could die before Christmas. In September, he was given 2 to 3 months to live. And he could die during the holiday season. And that's one of the reasons why I think we should be more sensitive to the way we stretch out these holidays. When you're dealing with a year like that, it's very, very painful. There are years where it's just not fun for everybody. And we shouldn't make them longer than they have to be because we're just prolonging some people's absolute agony. Because that year, it was just horrible for me to think about all the happy Christmases that Michael and I had. We had so many happy Thanksgivings, so many happy Christmases, so many happy New Years. And I knew that it was over. Like, this was it. This was all we were going to get. And Michael loved food, as I've talked about many times on the podcast. And on Thanksgiving, I mean, that was like his holiday. He was sitting at the table 3 hours before the meal was ready, preparing to eat. And after I met him, I added so many more dishes to Thanksgiving just because he just gobbled everything up. He loved everything. He appreciated everything. When you have somebody like that, you want to feed them. So I kept feeding him. And he would normally sit at the table long before the food was ready and be there still sitting at the table long after everybody else had pulled away from the table, groaning and saying, oh, I can't eat another bite. Michael was still there. Like, what else do we got? And then he would spend the next few days devouring leftovers. I mean, Thanksgiving was a huge deal to him. And he was funny. He was very funny on Thanksgiving. And then in 2008, I spent the day making the meal. And I called him to the table when the dinner was ready. He wasn't sitting there prior. I didn't want him to bring his wheelchair to the table. He wanted his wheelchair, so I gave in and let him put the wheelchair there. I wanted it to look like a normal Thanksgiving around the table. And the wheelchair was just a reminder that it wasn't normal, that things weren't normal. But I didn't want to fight with him, so I didn't say anything. I let him bring the wheelchair to the table. And then during appetizers, we're eating appetizers, and all of a sudden he just jumps out of the wheelchair into the regular chair, and he pushes the wheelchair like halfway across the room, and I had no idea what was going on. I had no idea what it was he was doing. And because of the brain tumor, he was doing some weird things like picking food up out of the bowls and eating it and throwing it back in. And then at one point, he looked like he was getting sick and just had radiation. He was still on chemo. And I thought, oh my God, like he's just going to throw up right on the table. I mean, that's what it looked like for a few minutes there. And then he got up, he jumped up from the table again, and he just started wandering around the house. I mean, like in the middle of dinner, like he just started wandering. And then he just went and sat in the family room. And I brought his plate into him. I didn't want him in the family room. I want him at the table. I wanted things to be normal. I wanted things to look normal. Things weren't normal. They didn't look normal. And I was pissed off about it. I'm like, I want everything to be normal. I don't want people sitting in the living room on Thanksgiving. I don't want there to be a wheelchair at the table. I don't want my husband wandering around the house, unsure what it is he's doing. I don't want to worry about him falling down the stairs at this point. I wanted everything to be normal. And I didn't want to recognize that it was our last holiday together. But it was, and it just kept coming into my head. Just let everything be. Just let everything be. Let everything be. And by Christmas, my heart was breaking because I knew that the new year was going to take him away from me. And inside, going up to Christmas, I hated everything and everyone. And on Christmas night in 2008, for the first time in 13 years, I cried myself to sleep. I tried so hard to be grateful for the 13 years that I hadn't cried myself to sleep, because that was something I had learned to do. I had learned to become grateful for the good times, for the years where holidays didn't cause me pain. And I tried very hard to will myself into gratitude, just like it says in the workbook and in the Power Affirmations book. I tried to will myself into doing my acceptance affirmations, my self-improvement affirmations, my gratitude affirmations, and it wasn't working. I just had to cry. On Christmas night, I just had to cry, and that's what I did. And then the next day, I got up and started working on gratitude again, because I learned through all those holidays from the time I was 5, looking at the bubble ornaments, that some days you need to grieve and other days you need to will yourself to be grateful for the times you weren't grieving. Good times ebb and flow. Holidays are sometimes magical and sometimes they suck. And like Carl Jung said, if we don't know the sad times, we won't appreciate the happy times. So Michael passed away in August, and in December, we didn't celebrate Christmas. We went to the Dominican Republic. And that family vacation was something that we all needed after the ordeal that the year had been. And I was surprised that I enjoyed myself as much as I did, but it was a special time alone with the kids and the grandkids, and I enjoyed it. I did take some walks on the beach alone to think about Michael and my heartache. It was my first Christmas without him. I spent some quiet time thinking about what he would say or do. I had my moments of incredible sorrow, but I had a surprisingly wonderful time. And I did my gratitude meditations, and they really helped me a lot. And I was grateful for the years that I had with him. And through all these ups and downs, what I've been able to do is assign some meaning to the holiday season. I once heard that the holidays are good, even if you don't celebrate anything, even if you hate the commercialism. because they cause us to reflect on the recent years, and we can mark the events of our lives by what the holidays say about us from year to year. And for me, they tell me that there have been good times and there have been bad times. And without the bad times, you wouldn't appreciate the good. Holidays aren't about going over budgets to give gifts or manufacturing mirth. They're about marking your life from one year to the next. The holidays should be a time of reflection and looking back on all your holidays, good and bad. Not every year is fun for everyone. 2020 has been very much not fun for most of us. And many years after a breakup, after a loss, they are not fun for that person. And right now, so many people are having a hard time. So then the holidays should become a time to reflect, a time to make sure that your priorities are in order, that you're not punching or pepper spraying anyone at the store, and to know that no matter what your experience is this year, it's unique to this year, and it will change, and you will change. And if you have some self-determination, you will orchestrate and direct that change so that next year will be better no matter what. You are the person that can make a difference. You are the person who can change you and should change you in the coming year. So that no matter what next Christmas brings, good, bad, or indifferent, you're ready for it. Whether you have to grieve or you have to will yourself to be grateful, you can be prepared next Christmas for whatever it is going to be about. If this year is a hard year for you, remember that good times are coming and that life is a cycle. And there will be good times ahead, even if you can't imagine them right now. Just take my word for it. There are good times. But if they are never balanced by the bad, we wouldn't appreciate them. So look back on the times when things were good and appreciate them and be grateful and know that good times, holidays, good holidays, bad holidays, magical holidays, horrible holidays, they all ebb and flow, and we never know what we're going to get from one year to the next. But whatever it is, we can find the grace and the goodness to accept whatever comes along, and we can honor and trust the process that it will be okay. The coming year will be okay. It will be a year of growth and change, and when we get to the holidays next year, we will be different people. And that will be okay. You can do this. I hope you all have very happy rest of the holidays. And I hope you have a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful 2021. 2020 is almost in the books. Good riddance to that. Talk to you guys soon. Happy holidays all. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.